And it does. A little bit smaller. Hard to see because they're both small. I guess I could put a bigger mass on them. Run the risk of breaking my twine. Anyway, there you have it. So let's talk about that. So, all right, there's more. I could write them all down. Your book has all the different, all the, you know, hollow sphere, solid sphere, hollow cylinders, you know, actually different axes. Okay, enough on moment of inertia. You get the idea. So now, what to do with it? You're asking great questions about, well, okay, so let's cut to the chase and talk about physics. Like, how do I relate this moment of inertia to what's going to happen to the motion of the object as a result of forces acting on it? So for that, we need to think about the analog of force, which is torque, angular acceleration. Right? So usually you've got force, right? Now we've got torque for the angular case, right? What's the definition of torque? Well, in the 7th series of Never Vision Physics, we would talk about torque as a vector. And we would define it this way. So I'll write it down to be general, for those of you who are familiar with it, also see an idea of what's going on. But then we're going to forever on think about it in terms of a scalar, as a number, with, and we'll keep track of the sign, right? But it'll be a number. So torque, what is that? Well, it's R cross, this is not time, it's not x, it's a cross product, force. R cross F, all right? What is a cross product? How many of you have seen cross products before? Actually, you've all seen them in your calculus class, right? How many have no recollection of having, you're taking a fifth, I understand. A fifth is you're not going to talk about. Doesn't mean you claim you don't remember. Different statement. So yeah, so cross product. So if you haven't, all the cross product is, so like dot product, you all know what a dot product is, an inner product. That's something that we actually use a lot in this class, like work is F dot delta X, right, for constant force and for force moving in the X direction, pointing in the X direction. Cross product maps you from two vectors to a vector, right? In this class, I'll give this in parentheses. We're not going to use this in this class. You will use cross products in 8B. Because when you get to electricity and magnetism, it's really unavoidable. But for this class, I'm not going to do it. But this sort of tells you where the formula we actually do use comes from. Here's the formula we will use in this class. The torque thought of as a number is equal to R times F, and I'll tell you what R and F are in a second, times the sine of the angle between those two vectors. So if you have some vector R and some vector F, there's some angle between them, theta. And oh, and now this is nasty. I've got theta down here and theta up here. Maybe just so nobody gets confused about what I mean, I'll use a different symbol for this particular angle. So let's call it, I don't know, we've already got an alpha, I can call it gamma or beta, let's call it beta, okay? Doesn't matter. It doesn't mean call data too. I just want to make sure that no one's confused. This is a different theta. This is a different angle coming up here than the one down here. This angle is some amount. How much of the wheel turn from the start of the problem? Something like that. But this angle is the angle between the force vector F and the radius vector R. Which radius is it? It isn't necessarily the radius of a circle of a wheel in some problem. It depends. So what I'm talking about now with torque. Here, I guess I'll do this. Here we go. So what do I mean by torque? I'll draw a picture over here. If I want to open a door, how do I do it? It's a very basic question, right? Well, if I got a door that's like this, I'll demonstrate with it. No, actually, no, I'm not going to move that door. The alarm go off, I touch that door. Maybe I won't. I'll just draw a picture. Yeah, at the end of class, I set the alarm off. All right, so let's say we're looking down from above and some door, and there's a doorknob right here. And of course, the doorknob is very suggestive. It's a place you want to put your hand to open the door. Even my daughter understands this now, which is a sad fact. So, how does this work? When you exert a force on the door to open it, if you were to grab that handle and push, this is the hinge right here, this is the hinge of the door. It's sort of a natural place to choose to make your pivot point. So, for this problem, let's make a separate indication of how this is our pivot point for the problem. All right, here's our pivot point. Now, if that's my pivot point, I'd like to open the door. What do I do? Well, if I exert a force that way, suppose I put my hand on the door and I push this way. I can push as hard as I want. I might break the handle off the door. I might break the hinge. I might hurt my hand. Something might happen, but I'm not going to open the door that way, right? If I want to open the door, I want to push it that way. I want to exert some force F on this part of the door. I want to open it up. You might say, wait a minute, I drew the hinge. That's not going to work. Yeah, so somebody on here thinks, oh, wait, hold on a second. Let's put the hinge up here. So that way I won't do as much damage to this one. There we go. Good. You're right. So as I drew that hinge down there, it was actually a door that opened this way. Okay, fine. So I'll put it right there. For this problem, we don't have to worry about that stuff so much. Let's say that the door is infinitely thin, so it doesn't matter. It's like a hinge. Real doors have thickness to worry about it. But that's fine. So yeah, good. So I put a force that way. What R am I talking about? When I have R in an equation, what I want is the radius that goes from the pivot point. I'll relabel. Here's my pivot point. Here's my hinge. Same thing in this problem. And I'm going to go this way. I'm going to go from the pivot point to the place where the force is acting. Well, if my hand's down here, let's say I'm on this side, they're pulling the door just so I can make an arrow that goes like that. Okay? So I've got a force that's exerted right here that's going up. I've got a radius that starts from the pivot point and goes to the place where the force is acting. And that's what I mean by R. And what do I mean by theta, or excuse me, beta, as I call it? Beta is the angle between this vector and that vector. Now remember, we're allowed in this class using affine geometry, fancy words, where we can move our vectors around as it's convenient for us to figure out what the angles are. So if I say, here's my radius vector, let's put it right here. There's my force vector. Okay, so that means this angle right here is my beta. Okay? It doesn't matter if you want to call this theta, really, because it turns out sine of beta is the same thing as sine of pi minus beta, which is what this is over here. So it doesn't really matter, but just to be consistent, so we have a definition we all agree on. What I mean by beta is the angle between the vector R and the vector F. What is F? F is the force vector I'm exerting on, or whatever it is. This happens to be the force I'm exerting on the object. So F me on object, right? And this is the radius from the pivot point to the place where that force acts. For any force acting on an object, and any choice for my pivot point, any choice for where the axis of rotation, well, now I'll stick with pivot point. The place where the pivot point is, I have a radius vector R. They aren't always at right angles to each other, but in this case, they're at right angle. It just turns out that I'm smart enough to know that I should pull straight out to maximize the torque for a given force, and for a given location of where I'm acting the force on an object. So this angle beta, if you say, well, what's sine of beta? What's sine of 90 degrees? What's sine of pi over 2 radians? What is it? Yeah, it's positive 1. That's good. I mean, I get the biggest possible number I could have from sine of beta. I get positive 1. I want to have a big torque if I want to get through that door in a hurry. If I want to accelerate that door as quickly as possible in the angular sense. I want to angularly accelerate it as fast as possible, which I usually don't want to do unless there's a window and I'm on the other side. But whatever. Actually, no, this case is going toward me, so it's okay. Well, hard as I want. So if I want a big angular acceleration, what I do is I pull hard and I pull right as far away as I can get from the hinge, a big R, and I pull at an angle that is, well, I pull along the direction that's at a right angle to R. That's the way I maximize my torque. And that will result in opening the door, not breaking the handle off or destroying the hinge or hurting my hands, right? Not exerting a big force that doesn't actually do anything. So this is different than work. Although we can talk about how much work you did, that's another question, but this is different than our dot products in work, right? Remember with work, you say, well, I'm going to exert the force. How much work am I doing on this chalk? Well, if I walk this way, I'm exerting upward force on the chalk, but the displacement in that case, delta X or delta R is that way, right? So in that case, I did zero work because force dot delta R, right, is zero. The dot product is zero for 90 degrees. But the cross product is the other way around. Cross products are maximal when things are at right angles to one another, when the two vectors and cross product. So you want to have the sine of beta biggest torque occurs when you push that way or pull that way in that direction of the radius. Now, you could have done something else and gotten the same torque, even if you pulled a different angle, but you have to exert more force. For example, suppose I exert a force from here, I'll use a different color. Suppose I exert a force like this. See that? So I exert a force that's up and to the left instead of straight up. Now, this is still exerting a non-zero torque on the door about this pivot point. Same radius vector, bigger magnitude for my force now, right? Longer vector here than this vector, bigger force, but because the angle now, so now I got a new beta, right? So I'll call beta sub 2 and F sub 2, just to distinguish it from my original ones. So that's an example where I got the same torque out, because now sine of beta 2 is actually smaller than sine of the original beta, but it's smaller by exactly the same amount as the length of this force vector got bigger than the original force vector. How do I know it's the same amount? Because this height is the same. The perpendicular height from here is the same. So when you think about dot products and cross products, there's a geometrical way to think about them. Remember with the dot product, you said, oh yeah, that's just a projection of one vector on the other. You can say, what's the projection of vector A on vector B? What's the projection of vector B on vector A? Take that projection, multiply it by the full length of the other vector, and that gives you length of A times length of B times cosine of the angle between them. Right? Well, the same sort of logic applies here. What I'm talking about now is the projection of the force vector on a vector that is perpendicular to R. These guys have the same orthogonal projection to R. They have different projections on R. This guy has a bigger projection on R than he does. But that's not what matters for cross for torque. For torque, it's that orthogonal component. So this orthogonal component, I'm going to break him up into components. You have a component like this, and a component like that. Well, this part has the same length as this original vector I had. Anyway, same thing over and over again. But that's a really useful way to think about it. And you can do it with the R vector or with the force vector. So sometimes the problem description will let it make it easy for you to read off from a drawing, make a really nice diagram. You can just read off and say, oh yeah, it's just, you know, the length is, you can just read off with the perpendicular component of F is perpendicular to the R vector. Or vice versa. It might be that you can really easily read off what the perpendicular component of the R vector is and you look at where the direction of the force vector. If that's true, take advantage of that and get your answer in a hurry and move on to the next problem. You don't have to sit there and calculate sine of whatever and do all that. You just read it off, depending on how the problem is described. Anyway, so one thing I have not done in this problem so far is define what I mean by my positive torque and negative torque. So I should define a positive direction. In the same way that we define a positive x direction, let me define an x axis. Right? Same idea. It's just your convention for the problem. So this is the way you're going to describe it. It's not a statement of physics. It's a statement of kinematics or the basic description. It's like your axes. So what I usually do is define clockwise as my positive direction for rotation. You don't have to do that. It's just what I tend to do. I just think of that as positive. But I always draw on my diagram so I don't forget or get confused or change my convention halfway through the problem and get all screwed up. Right? It's better to be explicit. So if I define a clockwise rotations as a positive direction for rotation, then when I describe the angle theta, well, actually, it'll happen. Let's not do that. When I describe my omega, the angular velocity, if it's going this way, I'm going to call it positive. If it's going that way, I'm going to call it negative. How about my acceleration? Well, if the acceleration is in this direction, suppose omega is this way. It's rotating like this, and it's speeding up with time. That's positive alpha, because alpha is in the positive, you know, clockwise, as I define it, positive direction for rotation. It's just like acceleration is for linear stuff, right? Where we, you know, the acceleration is, if something has positive velocity, as you define your x-axis, right? And it's speeding up, you say, oh, it's got positive acceleration. dv sub xdt is positive, so therefore it's positive acceleration. Same thing here, if the omega dt is positive, then alpha is positive. But you have to have a notion of what the positive and negative sense for rotations to do that. So I defined it here, I said, this is positive direction. Now the same thing is true for torque. In the same way that when you define the x-axis point this way, say, you say, all right, that means I'm gonna call this positive direction for accelerations and for velocities, right? Well, when you look at the force, if the force vector is pointing that way and there's a component along here, you say, oh, that's a positive x component for the force, because it's lined up with the positive direction of the x-axis, right? It's that way. Same thing for rotations. We talk about torque, so we calculate the magnitude by saying r times f times sine of beta, and then when we decide what is the sine of the torque, we can solve this part of the diagram and say, okay, I define this to be positive. So by this definition, is this a positive or a negative torque on the door? It's negative. Now what messes up 50%, maybe 80% of students in this class, these are the first see this, and some students never get this straight, but you will get it straight. When you're trying to figure out the sine of a torque in some problem, what you do is you say, if that force acted alone on the object, in this case, the upward force due to my hand on the doorknob, then which way would this object rotate if it starts at rest about the pivot point? So I put a nail through the object right here, say, I can't move right here, it's got to rotate about this point. In this problem, it turns out there really is a physical hinge where I just find my pivot point. That will not always be the case, but in this problem, it is. So it's pretty easy to think about. There's my pivot point. I'm exerting an upward force right here. Is the door going to rotate clockwise or counterclockwise? It starts from rest and I start exerting this force. And it's free to rotate here. It's not connected here. It's going to go clockwise or counterclockwise? Counterclockwise. Do you guys know what clockwise? Yeah. You know. My daughter probably will not know what clockwise is. We'll see. She has little digital stuff all the time. Plus, and she's not real good with time yet either. I'll tell you that. 5 minutes for her is an eternity. Anyway, so and for you guys, I know an hour and a half is an eternity. Anyway, so the upward force, you're very kind to laugh at. Anyway, so upward force right here? Yeah. Counterclockwise. So this particular force results in a negative torque as I defined the positive direction. Now in the 7th series class, there'd be some direction to the vector of torque. There'd be a vector. No vector in this class. Just a sign. But you've got to keep straight what you mean by positive and negative torque to be able to get through a problem when you get into this stuff. Okay, so that's how we define it. We've defined torque. So how do we use it? We've got a definition for torque. We've got our notion of, oh yeah, we always define the pivot point, check, right? And we define the direction for positive rotations, check, right? Got to do both of those things to make sense of this equation, get the sign right. So maybe I'll put a plus or minus here to indicate that the sign comes about from some other considerations beyond what I wrote in that equation. Great, all right. So now how do we use it? Well, for linear problems, we use Newton's second law. Right? And we're going to solve some problem. Almost, not always. Sometimes we use conservation of energy. But let's say we use the second law for some problem. What is that? Well, that says the net force. And let's just do it in the x direction. Equals mass of the object times the x component of acceleration. Well, I'm going to go a step further and say, well, really, when we were doing this in the past, we were really focusing on what part of the object are we talking about? I mean, some objects we talk about were small, but some were extended. Like my body. If I want to say F equals ma on my body, and there's some forces acting on me, we calculate the acceleration. Acceleration of what point in my body? Center of mass. It's important. Right? So that's the acceleration of the center of mass. Other parts of my body might be, if you have some rigid objects rotating, suppose the things flying through the air, bring it accelerating the gravity, it's falling the gravity. In it. So the center of mass is accelerating downward 10 meters per second squared. Well, there's other accelerations in different parts of the object. Right? So what does that look like? It looks like, what is the analog I'm trying to say for rotation? So what I'm going to write is Newton's second law, and I'll put a little alpha down here, or a little theta, or something like that to remind me that it's the angular version of Newton's second law. This looks exactly like this, where we substitute in the appropriate quantities, right? So what are they? Instead of force, what do we have? Torque. And it's a net torque. We don't need, so you have net torques as well as torques from each of the forces in the problem. If you have seven forces acting on an object, you got seven torques acting on the object. You add them up. Now normally, in this, you know, if torque is a vector, you vectorially add them up, right? But in this class, it's always going to be the case that they're in the board or out of the board, so the directions are the same. All you have to track is the sign. So in fact, when we put a sign on the positive direction for rotation, you know, by the right-hand rule, which we need to know, that would say that corresponds to a torque that would be a vector into the board. It doesn't matter. It's just there for those of you who are familiar with the right-hand rule for cross products and all that kind of stuff. It doesn't matter. If that makes sense, forget it. All that matters is that once you've assigned your convention for your sign for your torques, when you do your net torque, when you calculate that, you're adding up all the torques and you're keeping the sign straight. So when you add them up, make sure you don't just make them all positive unless they really are all going in the same direction. They're all counterclockwise. They're all clockwise or whatever it is. Okay, so what does that equal? Well, what's an analog of m? It's a what of what? Moment of inertia. And then that's acting on, and that's multiplied by a. What's the analog of acceleration? Angular acceleration. So this equation is really important. Newton's second law for rotations. We're going to wind up using it in lots of cases where you wouldn't think you'd have to. Turns out we need the statics in it next week. Statics are really just rotary motion problems in disguise. So we'll actually wind up using it in order to solve that problem, like figuring out what the forces are in a hinge beam in some building or something. You'll have to worry about this. But you use this equation in general. Sometimes you'll get away without it, but typically you'll have to use it. So great. We have to define our pivot point, and we have to define our direction for positive rotations. What else do we need? And we have to apply these notions to all parts of this when we calculate it. Very important. So let's think about it then. If I want to talk about how much angular acceleration alpha this thing was experiencing, well, the force in this problem, the torque. When I calculate it, how did I do it? Well, let's see, should I do that? Well, the thing is, we're not too far along. We're pretty far along in class. What I'm going to do in the beginning of next class is solve this problem in great generality, right, for calculating how fast did the guy go at the bottom. And we're going to also move on from, we're also going to get into energy. I didn't get far enough to kinetic energy today. Rotational kinetic energy. We're going to go there. But before you walk out, just real quick, let me just ask you this real fast. Whenever students are confused about torque and like, which has bigger torque and smaller torque and what does it mean, I think about this picture. This is one of my favorite pictures for this class. We're making sense out of stuff. If I want to move a big boulder in my backyard that's more massive than I am, I would have to move that thing. How do I do it? Well, one thing I could do is put the fulcrum right here, have a big lever, and then I can hang over here on this side, right? It's a big boulder, right? Or I could do this, right? I could have the same big boulder here, and I could put the fulcrum over here. Right? So, which is going to work better? The picture on the left or the picture on the right? Picture on the left is going to work better, right? And you know that. You have good intuition. So you have some great intuitions for torque. You know that. If I have this thing closer here, what does that correspond to? Here's a force I'm exerting on this end of this beam, right? This thing's exerting a downward force. I'm exerting a downward force on the beam. But this is a bigger lever. I have a bigger lever arm. I have more leverage, right? Bigger R, right? That gives me more torque. That allows me to rotate the beam the way I want it to rotate this way and have this boulder then, you know, get pushed away. Whereas over here, that's not what happens. Now I got a big force over here, a big R. He's exerting a gigantic. It turns out a negative torque is my convention because I find my positive torque that way. So when you get confused about torque and stuff, this is a picture to think back on to keep straight what's going on. And we'll do more of this on Thursday.